Hello everyone, good evening and thank you for joining us for our Thrilling Reads virtual event with author TM Logan. He'll be discussing his latest novel, Trust Me. My name's Philippa and I'm one of the senior librarians at Durham Libraries and I will be your host for this event. So hello. First, I need to thank Bonnier Books and the Reading Agency for the opportunity to host this event. And as these are sort of our first real virtual author events, we're kind of hoping we can do some more. Before I introduce the author, I will tell you a little about how everything's going to go. Tim is, first of all, going to jump in, introduce his book, and then give you an extract reading. Then we'll have a little bit of a discussion, and we'll finish off with some questions that you guys have sent in. At the end, I'll tell you all about where you can find copies of the books. But without further ado, hello, TM Logan.
Hello. How are you? I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. So are you okay to read us a little bit from your new book?
I can do, yeah. Yeah. It's just an extract from chapter one. So the story basically starts off when two strangers meet on a train. One of them's called Ellen. She's sort of the main character. And a young mum sits down opposite her and she's got a baby in her arms. She's quite flustered. Her phone keeps ringing. And so Ellen says, look, let me just hold the baby for a second while you get yourself sorted out. And so that all happens in the first couple of pages. And then this is where we come in. So Ellen's just literally, she's not a mum herself, so she's kind of just sort of holding this baby. It's all a bit awkward, but she's trying to look after the baby's called Mia. And so that's where we come into the story. Mia reaches out, the tips of her fingers brushing my cheek with the lightest of touches, tiny points of warmth on my skin. She makes a happy gurgle of delight as I lean closer, allowing her fingers to touch my chin, my jawline. I reach over with my right hand and Mia's fingers wrap around my index finger, a tiny clamp as gentle as a feather. She has the smallest, most exquisite fingernails. I blow a raspberry onto her fingertips and she giggles. Nice to meet you, Mia. I smile down at her. My name is Ellen. Catherine's phone starts ringing again, vibrating against the plastic tabletop. The screen displays a man's face, 30-ish, dark ginger hair, stubble, a kink in the bridge of his nose, as though at some point it's been broken. The name below the image is Dominic. Sounds like he's keen to get hold of you, I say. I'd better answer. She looks again at the phone's display. Would you be all right with me just while I take this call? It's urgent. Sure, I say. Go ahead. We'll be fine for a minute. I'll just be down there. She gestures over her shoulder, down the carriage. I'll be back. I look up again and I swear I see tears glistening in her eyes. Catherine, are you sure you're all right? Yeah, she says, getting up out of her seat. Thank you. I won't be long. She reaches out and touches her fingertips gently to the crown of the baby's head, as if reluctant to leave her even for a moment. Then she takes her phone down the aisle, towards the end of the carriage, the mobile clamped against her ear. Mia gazes up at me and yawns, her blue eyes blinking shut for a moment. I rock her gently from side to side, her wonderful weight in the crook of my arm, the unfamiliar smile returning to my lips. My heart fills my chest, a powerful rush like the strongest drug, a tide of emotion I haven't felt in so long that I've wondered whether it even still exists inside me. I allow myself to imagine, just for a moment, what it would be like if this little one was mine. If I was returning from the hospital with a baby in my arms, instead of a prognosis even bleaker than the last time. To finally use the little box bedroom for what it had been intended for, saved for, a nursery. Instead of a quiet, empty corner of the house left in stasis like a shrine to a life unfulfilled, to something that would never be. I've imagined this for so long, dreamed of it, of night feeds and cuddles and tiny fingers, walks in the park and first words and bedtime stories. All those little things that parents take for granted. I lean closer to Mia's forehead, breathing in that indefinable, soft, sweet baby scent of pure, clean skin, talcum powder and new life. wondering if Catherine knows how lucky she is. There's a shift in the train's momentum, its speed easing as it comes into the next station, the last stop before Marylebone. Open countryside has been replaced by busy little villages and roads, church steeples and barn conversions, commuter land on the way into northwest London. I look up to see if Catherine's on her way back, but she's still hidden from my view at the end of the carriage. How long has she been gone now? 2 minutes? Three? The next stop slides into view. Sear Green and Jordan's, a little two-platform country station with a footbridge and a small wood-panelled waiting room. A handful of people waiting to board. Catherine has not reappeared. The train wheezes to a stop in a shudder of brakes. Three long beeps as the carriage doors slide open and a few passengers step down to the platform. I raise myself carefully from my seat and look around, checking the other way down the carriage in case Catherine has somehow slipped past while I've been busy with Mia. But all I can see are the football fans, all in identical red and white striped shirts with close-cropped hair, long legs sticking out into the aisle. The seats across from me are occupied by a small red-faced man in a pinstripe suit who has managed to spread out his briefcase, laptop, newspaper and raincoat across five of the six seats, as well as the little table. He's not looked over at me once. "Excuse me," I say to him. "I don't suppose you saw the woman sitting here. Did she come past us just now?" The man glances up, gives a single irritated shake of his head and goes back to his laptop. I'm about to stand up to walk down the carriage in search of her when movement outside catches my eye. A figure hurrying past, right by the window. A blonde woman in a rust-coloured jacket. Catherine is walking away down the platform. So that's the first chapter, or some of the first chapter, trust me.
Well, to be fair, it sounds fantastic, and immediately... when I'm listening, I'm just like, oh my, what would I do? Like, if I was put in that situation, what would I do? Was that sort of your idea to have a situation that, I mean, it could happen, let's be honest, it could happen to anybody. Was that your plan to sort of have a real life situation?
Yeah, I like to make the story sort of relatable if I can. So although it's quite, you know, it's obviously pretty unusual situation, it sort of could, you know, could happen, and we've all been on trains and buses or whatever where there's been people there with small kids. And I mean, the idea first came to me when I was at an ice hockey match, and there was a family with a little baby in a few rows in front of us, and this baby was just beaming at everybody, smiling and grinning, and really kind of one of those really smiley, happy babies. And I remember just thinking, I think it was at a boring point in the match or something, but I was just thinking, you know, I wonder if I could still remember what you're supposed to do when the kids are that small, because mine are like, my kids are 18 and 21, so it's obviously a long time ago when, you know, and I was thinking, would I remember about all the stuff you have to think about and all the things you have to carry and all the, you know, all the kind of the things that go along with the small baby. And then I was thinking, well, how about if the mum then sort of, you know, wasn't there or disappeared? And how about if I was in a situation where I couldn't immediately just find someone, you know, to sort of hand the baby to, like on a train or something like that. So yeah, it was very much sort of a one idea, and it sort of span off in all these different directions, and that's where the story originally came from.
Yeah, so obviously you got that inspiration from that little girl at the hockey match, but the sort of the characters that you got from that initial idea, are they sort of based on people you know, and are, you know, the places that you've set it in, are the places that you know, that you've used, that you've been to?
Yeah, some of the places so I used to live for a few years. We lived in a place called Loudwater, which is High Wycombe. So it's in Buckinghamshire, sort of near London. We work my wife and I both working in London, so we live there. And some of the parts, so Sear Green and some of those other little villages around there are nearby to where I used to live. So it was set, yeah, pretty much in around there. I mean, there's the other parts of it that are in London. But then with other books, so for example, like with The Catch, my last book, that was set in Nottingham, where I live, and that was all kind of all in the neighbourhood around, you know, my own sort of near my house. So yeah, most of the time I'm sort of using places that I know, or I've lived in the past, or I'm sort of, you know, a bit familiar with. And then people, I don't tend to, I mean, I sometimes use people's, like, some attributes from people or some characteristics from people I've known. I wouldn't probably tend to base person completely on on a real person, because I find that some names as well, if I use certain names, like if I use it like my mate Paul, for example. So if I have a character called Paul, I'm just going to be constantly thinking of the real Paul the whole time. So I normally have to use, you know, it has to be a bit separate from kind of from reality in terms of real people. Otherwise, I'm just thinking of the real person all the time, which is, you know, can be quite distracting. So they tend to be just sort of mostly coming out of my head.
Yeah, I quite like the fact that you'd use a lot of things that you know, because I think, well, for me, like the thought of writing a novel is quite daunting, because you think, you know, the idea is that it's all your imagination, you've got to get it all from the depths of your mind. You know, if you think of Harry Potter, it's just completely made up, whereas I don't know, the way you write seems a bit more accessible, which is quite nice. I like that.
Yeah, and I think why I the other thing that was always kind of in my head, certainly for the first few books, I wrote a book before my first published book, which was called, first one that came out was called Lies, 2017. I wrote one before that, just spent about 6 years writing, which was set in America and set in Boston mostly. And because I've been to visit and stuff, and we had some friends there, and that book went out to loads of publishers and didn't get published. None of them wanted to publish it. So from that, I kind of thought maybe I should kind of, you know, come a little bit closer to home and write a bit more about places I know or places I've lived. And I've deviated from that a bit. So I had one book set in the south of France, you know, the holiday. But I do like to use places that I'm a bit more familiar with, and either sort of from now or from in the past. Or I mean, you can always go and visit places as well. And done that as well, going out to visit places, and obviously you can take loads of video and take loads of pictures, and it's always helpful to sort of bring places to life.
Yeah, often writing from a female perspective, which you do well. How have you achieved that? Have you had help? Have you just had inspiration, or did it just kind of happen?
Yeah, I do have quite a bit of help with that. So I have, so the first three people who read any like sort of first draft that I write will be my editor, my agent, and my wife. So that's three female perspectives straight away on the sort of the writing. They really help to sort of, because the first draft can be a bit obviously it's kind of work in progress. So yeah. they kind of really put their input into that in terms of you know, sort of more female perspective. But I do try to, I mean, it's with any character really, you're just trying to see the world through their eyes. And I think in some respects it's a bit easier to do that if you can step outside yourself. And you know, if I'm writing from a sort of perspective of my own, you know, someone like me, it can be a bit, sometimes you take things for granted, I think. Whereas if you step outside yourself and you really kind of make the effort to look at the world through, you know, that other person's eyes, I think the writing can benefit from that actually. So and I will always tend to pick, I think I've got six books, well, I'm still writing the sixth one now, but of the six books so far that I've got, they've been sort of half and half in terms of is it a male protagonist or a female protagonist. So I tend to just sort of try and work out how I can best tell the story really, rather than saying this book will have a male or female sort of lead. So yeah, it seems to be going sort of 50-50 at the moment.
Yeah. So when you start writing, have you got a sort of a particular routine or somewhere that you write? And, you know, obviously like we were saying earlier, you were at the hockey game when the idea for your newest Trust Me came to you. But you know, if something does come to you, do you, you know, write it down, do you put it in your phone, or do you just hold it in your brain?
Yeah, I'm not really good at holding things in my brain. So I tend to, I just know that if I think, like, you know, I've got to write it down. So I've got, often my phone with me most of the time, I've got a notepad by the bed, because it'll often be things last thing at night or first thing in the morning that I'll kind of then just scribble down. So they kind of just, you know, bring them up. Yeah. So I'll do that. I've got a little notebook as well, and I need to write them down straight away really, and then I sort of put them all into one document on the computer and sort of feed them in. Sometimes they're little bits of dialogue, or they might be, you know, chapter ideas or things about the story or about the characters. But yeah, it's quite a slow sort of gradual process. So I like that. I hear some authors sort of saying, you know, the whole thing came to me in one amazing moment. And yeah, that doesn't really happen for me. It just kind of slowly sort of more of like a building process, like building a house kind of thing. So yeah, and routine. You're asking about routine as well, were you?
Just have you got one or?
Yeah, so I've got I've got a little cabin at the end of my garden, which is kind of like a writing place. And I try and come down here every morning by about 8, try and get maybe 4 or 5 hours of writing before lunch. And because my mornings are the best time. So I'll try and, yeah, not mess about too much, not procrastinate too much, and try not to look at emails and stuff like that. Just come down here, get into the writing, pull the blinds down and, you know, put my headphones on, and then just sort of lose myself in the writing process. So that's the mornings. And then I'll have a bit of lunch, maybe to go for a run or something, then come back and do some editing of what I've written that day, and looking back at that, and also looking forward to what I might do the following day. And then I'll do sort of admin stuff later in the afternoon. So I find that if I don't have a structure, because I thought when I was made redundant, like in 2017, and I thought when I was first started, I came back, I was at home and I was like thinking, oh, I've got a whole day to work and it's going to be amazing and I'll get so much done. And then for the first few weeks, I was like getting to 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon and I hadn't actually like done anything, just because I've been, you know, so I thought I've got so much time, I kind of, you know, it kind of blows your mind a little bit, because I've worked in an office for a lot of years, and when you suddenly present it with all that free time, it kind of I need a little bit of structure in the day to make sure that I make use of the hours that I've got.
Yeah, I think that happened to a lot of people during the lockdown, didn't it? It was, you know, this, I've got loads of time, yeah. What do I do with it? But obviously for you, the lockdown probably didn't have quite that effect, because your routine was at home really, and you had it kind of set up already.
Yeah. So there's a bit, it was a bit different in lockdown because my kids were here and my wife was obviously working from home. So it's a bit, it's a bit more busy in the house, but in terms of trying to writing a first draft, because most of the first draft of this book was written during that first lockdown. It was written from February to June last year. So yeah, a lot of it in lockdown. So the house was a bit busier. But apart from that, it was quite similar to what I've been doing pre-lockdown. So yeah, I know it can be a bit of a solitary thing, a sort of solitary job, but you know, I don't mind that too much. But I think it is also good to get out of the cabin occasionally and go out there, otherwise you can go a little bit kind of, you know, a little bit stir crazy. So
yeah, and this book is your first hardback one, which
it is, yeah.
Is wonderful. For anyone who doesn't know how much of a big deal that is, can you explain that a little bit and tell them how you felt about that as well?
Yeah, it's kind of a milestone on the sort of writing for a writer. It's my fifth book, the first one that my publisher thought would you kind of get to a stage where they think you've got enough. Some people know you out there, and you know, you're not a complete kind of unknown, so it is a kind of a mark of a little bit of their confidence in you, and sort of them saying, we think that, you know, we can, because obviously the you know, it's a bit more substantial, it costs a bit more to make and produce and stuff, so it's a kind of a indicator of them saying, yeah, we think you're now at sort of this stage in your career. And and it's also just really nice to have, you know, so getting your first paperback is pretty amazing day as well. And that was, you know, 2017 for me, but this is definitely another big sort of like a milestone on the road, really. And there will be a paperback later in the year of this, but that's obviously, you know, it comes out first in hardback, ebook and audio.
Yep. So you mentioned, you know, you're getting first published in paperback. How does it compare, the sort of just actually being published and, you know, being published in hardback? Like, is it a similar sort of feeling? Is it better to when you, you know, is it more elation when you first get published?
I think it is definitely, probably the first time is hard to beat, I think, because, you know, the first time you get some proof copies originally, and which are kind of not like final versions, and then you get, you know, a few weeks before it comes out, and kind of get a box arrives at the house, and, you know, and you open it up, and it's like, you know, there's literally the book, you've 12 or 15 of your books in there that you've, you know, and you're holding it in your hand, paperback or whatever it is, you hold it in your hand for the first time. It is quite a special kind of moment for that idea to have gone all the way through all the kind of stages it had to sort of finally be something you can, you know, hold in your hand and give out to people, or hopefully, you know, get them to buy copies. Having the hardback is a close second, but yeah, the first paperback was a real special moment.
Yeah, and your book covers, they are, love your book jackets, because I've got the holiday here.
Okay.
And obviously, being in a library, we file these in our sort of crime thriller section, and this just pops in that, you know, usually you've got really dark sort of solitary person on the front cover. And trust me, it's a little bit darker, but there is still that pop of colour, and it does make you stand out in that section. So how much influence did you have over that? Did you have any say at all, or did you have a little bit, none?
I had a little bit, so there were normally, it's been a bit different with each cover, to be honest, because with a few of the books before that, they've said, we've got like three different, quite different front covers, quite different images and sort of the way all the text is laid out. Then for the next book, it was more like, we've got different types of colour. So here's a sort of an orange version, a yellow version, I can't remember what the other one was, but, you know, different kind of colourways. And then with the holiday, it was more, because they obviously have lots of conversations in-house before it kind of presented to me. And I think they'd reached a point where they were like, we quite like this, what do you think? And so they'd send me the graphic. And like you say, it did kind of, you know, it does sort of jump out at you as soon as you see it. And once they had... I had a few working titles for the drafts as I've been working on it, and they then, one of the guys at the publisher said, well, and I was like, okay, does what it says on the tin. And I was like, well, there's that film with Jack Black and I can't remember, but yeah, called The Holiday, but is that a problem? And they're like, well, probably not, it's you know, that was years ago. So but yeah, so that they, the cover of The Holiday, they sort of, I liked it, my agent liked it, and I just thought it was quite a good, there were some tweaks to it, and there were some sort of quite small tweaks after that, but that they were fairly minimal. And I think it's interesting because you then get kind of foreign editions, and some of them have very similar front covers, mm-hmm. and some go completely different. So it's quite a, I just want to see if I can grab a couple here. So this one, That's The Holiday as well, which is Polish, I think.
Yeah.
That's kind of similar-ish. Then you've got that one, which I think is Bulgaria. I'm not sure. Yeah, again, pretty different. You wouldn't necessarily know it's the same book. But then you've got that one, which is very similar.
Yes, it is.
Which is Greek. And so, yeah, they all kind of, you know, have their own sort of take on it, but yeah, it's a kind of collaboration with the front covers, and I'm not particularly good at that sort of thing, so I tend to just say, well, you know, see what you can come up with, and then we'll sort of talk about it. But they do a pretty good job, and I think they've done a good job with Trust Me as well.
Yeah, definitely. I'm impressed with your covers. I am. So you did good. So I mentioned The Holiday, and that's been adapted for TV, which is amazing. How do you feel about that? I think it'll do really well. I think it's sort of a really, I just think it'll do well. It's a perfect candidate to be adapted for TV. How did that feel when you were sort of approached with that?
Yeah, it's great. They're sort of because the first two books have been optioned for TV as well, for the screen, and that kind of hadn't really quite worked out. So when it happened for The Holiday, I thought, well, that's good, and, you know, well, fingers crossed. And but there's many there aren't many books that get optioned that actually end up being made. So to have reached a sort of point where it's, yeah, it's going to be on TV is quite a mind blowing, really. And I was on Friday, just gone, I was on a Zoom call where there was like a read through, a full cast kind of read through of the first two episodes of the script. So all I could see all the cast members kind of on the screen, and literally just really going through the script. And it was, yeah, that was quite a surreal kind of moment, really. And a few of the, some of the actors were really sort of quite well known, and I'd seen them in other things, and I'm not allowed to tell you who they are, but it'll be different, I think, on the TV. It'll be a different, the book will be one thing and the TV series will be another thing. And I'm trying to sort of let them, there's a really good script writer attached to it who's done a really good job, and I've read all the scripts and been asked for my feedback and stuff. So I think it's going to be fascinating to see it on the screen, maybe later this year or early next year. I'm not sure exactly when it'll go out. But
it's great. So what is next for you? Are you going to continue to write? I assume you are.
Yes, I'm writing my book 6 at the moment, which is just over halfway done. And I've got another couple of months to finish the first draft of that. So, I need to crack on with that, really. But the working title is The Alibi. And that is, it's about a family and teenage son. He gets involved in something quite bad, and the parents then cover for him. They give him an alibi. They say he wasn't out this time and this thing happened. They give him that alibi, and without really thinking about what's the best thing for him or for them or for the, the parents of this other child that has gone missing in their sort of peer group. So yeah, it's exciting. It's kind of at that stage now where I'm really quite far into it, and it'll be probably another 40,000 words before the first draft is done. But it's kind of crunch time now. So I have until June the 1st to submit. So it seems like quite a long time, but actually I found lockdown has kind of gone really fast. So in the lockdown timing, I was like, a minute ago it was January, and now it's virtually April. I'm like, so it's the days are going quite quickly.
But you've met other deadlines for several other books, so you'll be able to get there.
I hit the deadline sort of there or thereabouts with
Right, so we haven't got too long left, so I've got a few questions that have been sent in, if I can ask you some of them.
Yeah.
One of them that we've had in, would you write a book series? And if so, how do you think the writing process differs to writing a standalone novel?
I would like to write a series, and I have said this, I've said this before, and I feel like one day I will do it. But I would love to write a series, maybe with a continuing character. And I think the trick of it is, well, one of the tricks, which is quite hard to pull off, but I think someone like Lee Child has done it really well. So you want to be able to dip into any of the books in any sequence and understand it and get it and enjoy the book as a one-off, I think that's sort of, it's harder than it sounds, I think, to be able to. Mm-hmm. And there's probably lots of other examples of that, but you can either read them in, you could read them in sequence if you want to, or you can pick one up in any order and still get the enjoyment out of it. So I think that's probably one of the biggest challenges, and obviously having those continuing characters and having the sort of character arcs of them changing over time. I think that would also be, a change from my sort of standalone so far. But I would love to write a series. I'd love to be able to write if I could write two books a year, that's what I'd do. I'd write one standalone and one sort of series book, and that would be, like Ian Banks, whatever he used to do. He was Ian Banks for one set, wasn't he? Then Ian M. Banks for the other. Mm-hmm. So that would be good. But I need to be a bit quicker, to be honest, to make that happen.
Yeah, but you're doing well. There's a lot of writing going on, to be fair. So you're doing well.
Yeah.
Another question we've had kind of links to that one, just where you mentioned Ian Banks there. Would you consider writing in another genre? If so, which genre, And would you use a pseudonym?
I'd like to write something in the historical sort of genre. Mm-hmm. Absolutely love Bernard Cornwell, and I love the fact that he is sort of, you know, he's not just he doesn't just do the sort of Anglo-Saxon stuff. He does the obviously the sharp novels, 19th mm-hmm. century. He's done the sort of the American Civil War books, and I think he's going back a bit those ones. But you know, he kind of seems to just go wherever he wants to go and make brilliant stories. So I would like to do. Yeah, I'd like to do historical. That would probably be the one I would lean towards. And I actually do write under a pseudonym. So that's Logan is a pseudonym. So whether I'd use another one, I don't know. Maybe, probably not. I would probably stick with this one because it's confusing enough having one pseudonym, let alone having two.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I was like, one's enough. So next, what is the best piece of advice you have been given by another author or anyone, and what advice would you give someone thinking of starting to write?
I would best piece of advice, I think, I mean, Stephen King has written this great book called On Writing, which I'm sure if you've got sort of aspiring writers out there, they're probably aware of it or may have even read it. And he's got some brilliant advice in there. But I think the key things are, you need to read quite a lot, read across different genres, try to read as if you're a writer, try to read something and have a think about it afterwards. You know, think about, did I really love that chapter? Did I really love that character, that sequence? And why did I love it? And what's the author done there? That sort of thing, and sort of vice versa as well. And I think if you really want to try and write, so what I did was quite a while ago, quite a few years ago now, was just trying to set aside a little bit of time each day, maybe 40 minutes or an hour or however much time you can get, and just write. And whatever it is, whether it's short stories or maybe a character sketch or a description of somewhere you've been or something you've done. You just need to get that writing sort of muscle going, sort of thing, and so that it becomes a bit more of a natural thing, so that you're not intimidated by the blank page. And I was, before I sort of started doing this full time, which was only 4 years ago, I was in jobs. I was a journalist, and I was in another job where I was, you know, a press officer. So And that one of the good things about that is it was just writing every day. So it becomes kind of natural almost. It becomes, you're not bothered by having a blank white screen in front of you. It's just sort of something you do. So I think if you can write every day and read every day, that's probably a pretty good start.
Excellent. And the last one we've got is, reading has helped people a lot in the last year. What does reading mean to you?
I mean, it's always been one of my favorite hobbies, and I love being able to escape, I suppose. And every year I kind of, at the beginning, one of my New Year's resolutions is I'm going to try and read a few more books than I read the year before. And I still seem to have such a massive pile beside my bed that I'm not, you know, last year I read like 35 or something, and I'm still way behind on all the ones I want to read. But it's just a sort of my favourite hobby, probably, I suppose. Something I've always gone back to, and something, you know, just being able to escape and look into someone else's life and experience kind of someone else's reality, even though it's fiction, it's kind of someone else's world, isn't it? So I just think it's my favourite way to sort of spend time. And I do read every day, and I try to try to read widely, although most of the stuff I'm reading at the moment is in the thriller genre, because I get sent quite a few sort of advanced review copies and stuff like that. So, but yeah, I've always loved, right from as long as I can remember, I've loved to read and to write. So.
Great. Well, thank you very much. That's the end of our little chat. For anyone who wants to read either Tim's latest book or his past back catalogue, they are all available on BorrowBox right now. If you are not a member of Durham Libraries, you can join online at www.durham.gov.uk/library online. And you can follow us on Facebook at County Durham Libraries and on Twitter at Durham Libraries. We have another video as well with David Fennell, which will be available for you to watch again, as will this one. So please do share it with your friends and go and find Tim's book. Thank you so much for being with us, Tim. It's been really fantastic.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me.
Good luck with this book and your future ones.
Thank you.